and you would like to we'll get to that momentarily. Is that all right? Okay. If you have your Bibles, you can open to the book of Ephesians. And you will have to pardon me as I reference my phone a lot.
Hey, Missy, make it not go off.
Is that horrible?
Okay. Fix it. That way I don't have to do anything with it.
My brother Bill called me the other day and he said, Sean, I need you to come and help Daniel, his son Daniel, with a project, a PowerPoint project he had to do for school. And I said, okay. And so immediately I loaded up Justin and we went to Bill's house and I let Justin out to help Daniel with the project me and Bill talked about the Bible. So there it is, if you got it already. Maybe. Okay, thank you. So, anyhow, now that my wife has spared me, Ephesians chapter 4, I'll tell you the verse in a moment. I want to give you a little setup though. This message has been 2 or 3 weeks in the making. And not that I've had to study for it that long, but just that God has really stirred me on it. And you got to bear with me for a little bit here while I jump through a piece of testimony or history. I was the other day on YouTube, and we have a YouTube channel here at the church, and occasionally I'll get on YouTube and I will look and see how many views we've had or whatever. And in so doing, there come up a video, because, you know, YouTube being one of them smart things will show up things that it'll think you're interested in. You know what I mean? And on that video or on that page come up, yes, baby. Screen will stay on. Do I need to give that back? Yes, please. Thank you. And I need to be more specific. Pray specifically. Lord, preached about that one time. But anyway, and one of the videos that came up was a video about a man who was condemning the Pentecostal movement. And it was 7 minutes or something. It was not a big deal. And I thought that was interesting. You know, I watched it. And I watched several videos that night, probably about 6 or 7 videos in all, and I started not to watch them, Sister Tony, but I thought, you know what, if we're right, then I've got nothing to fear.
John.
Right? I mean, by watching, I've got nothing to fear. And I watched a couple videos along that lines. I watched one poor old condemning Brother Kenneth Copeland, and I didn't find it very valid, but that's another conversation. I watched one that was very much Calvinistic, as the term would go, and had a lot to say not only about Pentecostalism, but predestination. I watched some that had to do with the worldwide Church of God. Actually, I believe the word was the restored Church of God, which is a branch of the worldwide Church of God, which is a totally different group of people from what we are. And then not only is there that whole column of things that I watched, and I'm going to be honest with you, they had a couple valid points, but it didn't change my mind on nothing. But they had this whole column of these videos, Brother Kevin, that was contrary to what we say we typically believe. And then you've got this whole column over here, Brother John, of videos of people that say they are what we are, but they're clearly doing things we don't agree with. Can you say amen? And I thought for a minute, Dad, and God really stirred me about how ugly a mess that our churches really are. And days, Brother Jordan, days, the Lord just racked me over that and another topic, which we'll preach at another time. But He really just bothered me over this, Dad. And it was like this. If I was a sinner, and I thought, I'm going to seek out God. And I don't know for whatever reason why that you would turn to YouTube to find God, but let's just say you did. It doesn't matter what you do or where you go. You find this big picture of shattered ideas and disunity. And I thought, how in the world do we expect somebody who don't know anything about this to be able to find what God really is? If I was an atheist, if I was a man who had known nothing about God, Brother Ty, and I decided to find out about God, who do I believe? Do I believe the televangelist who's asking me to sow a seed for $30? Do I believe the man who waves his hand and droves the people, hit the floor under the Spirit? I'm not saying they're not. I'm just making another observation. Do I believe the man who says that these other people are wrong? Do I believe the man who says it was all predestined and it's all going to work out the way it is anyway? I mean, what do we do with all these ideas? And God really began to deal with me on the shattered state of the church. And the church, listen to this, the church is God's people showing the love and compassion and the truth of God through Christ's names. We are the perfect living organism made of individuals to show God's everything in unity. Does that make sense? That was God talking, that ain't me. And I didn't steal that quote from nobody. When we are not in unity or showing love, etc., then we are fractured. Brings us to our first set of verses that has to do with what we're supposed to look like. Now, in a minute, I'm probably going to refer to, as a matter of fact, I refer to it now, in Matthew chapter 16, you don't have to turn there. And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock." Can everybody say rock with me? Rock. One rock.
Yep.
Dad, one rock. Brother Blake, one rock. There wasn't two, Andrea. Wasn't two, Kyle. There was one. He said, upon this rock, I hate to tell you, but it wasn't Peter that he was talking about. He was talking about what had been revealed to Peter. Because Peter had just said, Jesus said, "But who do you say I am?" And Peter said, "Thou art the Christ."
Amen.
The living Son of God. Come on. And Jesus just answered that and he said, "Let me tell you something, Peter." He said, "That wasn't flesh and blood, but it was God that showed you that. And upon the Son of God, upon the Christ, upon the rock, I will build my church."
Yep.
Now listen, hallelujah, y'all going to have to ride with me for a minute. "And the gates of what? Hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Ephesians chapter 4 verse 3 says this. He says, "Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." There's two words right there that are crucial. The unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as we are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you.
Come on.
All.
Amen.
Boy, that's kind of tough stuff, Brother Jordan. That either means that we're the only one right, or we got some bad things going on.
Come on.
Amen? Give you another one. You don't have to turn. John 13, 34 says, "A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another." That's the only time that a new commandment was issued from the time the law was laid down. That's the only time we ever read those words, Sister Diane, is right there when Christ Himself spoke. And He said, "I give you a new commandment." A new commandment. He said this is an addition to or supersedes or surpasses everything else that I have spoken. He said, "I give you a new commandment." He said, "That ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this," listen, "by this," by what? "By loving one another, all men," who? All. Think about it, John. He didn't say
another. Romans 12:18, if it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men.
Well, that's a picture of unity, right? Ain't that beautiful? Picture of love. A picture of something functional. A family unit, if you will. A family unit supposed to have like parents and children and everybody's happy, right? Kind of, sort of. Ain't that how that's supposed to work? I know we don't see that much. I want you to remind me of something. I want you to remind me of something. Remind me who all heard their language on the day of Pentecost. Everybody that was there. That they named off, I don't know, I've not counted them, a dozen or more languages, maybe. That was, if you go back to Acts chapter 2 and 3, Brother Kevin, and it said every man heard them speaking in tongues in their own language. Yeah. And it said they were there from all over the world, Brother Jordan, to worship God in the temple. And I'm going to tell you something, Sister Tony. It wasn't just rich men, and it wasn't just poor men, and it wasn't just Jews, and it wasn't just the Greeks. Come on. Hey, we read, as a matter of fact, a few chapters over, that there was an Ethiopian that was going away from Jerusalem after he had worshipped God. And there he was, an Ethiopian of great power. And then you had this poor old Jew named Philip that come to him.
Yeah.
You see, the church was never meant. Oh. Listen. The church wasn't never meant to be white.
That's right.
And the church wasn't meant to be black.
That's right.
And it wasn't meant to be brown or red or yellow or whatever other color we want to throw in there, Brother Jordan. The church was supposed to have been a mixed bag of tricks, Brother Kevin. They were supposed to have been all races, creeds, and nations that was going to be inside the church, yeah. Brother John. And they had one door, they had one house, and they had one name. Come on, because they served one Father God.
Yeah.
Oh, somebody ought to hear it tonight. I'm talking about unity. I'm talking about unity in the body of Christ. I ain't talking about unity in the Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee. I ain't talking about the First Baptist. Come on. I'm talking about unity in the body of Christ.
Yeah.
Preach it.
Asked Brother Mark Knight, pastor from down toward Ashland. I said, Brother Knight, I said, if you could pick a tool, a utensil, a piece of furniture to be a representation of the church, what would it be? I said, I don't care. I said, anything. He said, I would pick a funnel. He said, I'd pick a funnel. He said, because it continually pours out everything that comes in it, but there's always more coming in than it's letting out.
Come on now.
And I thought, man, that's good. But I can't get a funnel and make it look pretty in front of people. So I got me a vase. If we want to make it sophisticated, it's a vase. I'm not going to tell you how much I paid for it. I wanted a bigger one, but I was too tight. I didn't think it was good use of my money. You notice what's in that vase? Ain't that pretty? Look at that. We got some clear rocks, and we got some green rocks, and some blue rocks, and some purple rocks. I don't know what they'd be. But you see how that's all mixed up? You see how that's all together? There ain't no pile of green rocks. Oh, no. Here this time you thought I was talking about race. We might be talking about denomination. Uh-oh.
Yeah.
There ain't no green rocks, Brother Jordan. There ain't no pile of white rocks. And there ain't no pile of clear rocks, Brother John. But them things are all wrapped up together, Brother Tim. And they're serving one purpose inside one instrument. Can you say amen? Amen. I like the flowers, don't you? Ain't them pretty? I had two more pretty ones and I left them in the house in a bag of clothes. So we had to rogue a couple from the church. So that's all right. You forgive me from stealing from the church, right? We'll put them back when we're done. But you see, when you look at this imperfect unity, is it not pretty?
Yeah.
Ain't that a, okay, now listen. I know maybe the flowers ain't the best, but they serve a purpose. Roll with me here. Ain't this pretty? Ain't that nice when it's together? And you want to know what it does when it's together, Brother Jordan? It bears fruit.
You see, when it's together, the church serves as a place not only that will pour out the Spirit of God, but it serves a place, Brother Tim, where people can lay their roots down, where people can grow in Christ. And Brother John, Sister Ray, you begin to see the fruit of God coming out of that. You say, what do you get when you get unity? I get 3,000 people added to the Church of God in one day. Come on.
Yeah.
So you back that up? Yeah. I had 120 in the upper room. Come on. And they were in one mind and one accord. Amen. They didn't care who they were and they didn't care what they were doing. They had one purpose under heaven, and that was wait for God to tell them what to do next.
Yeah.
And the Spirit come down with cloven tongues of fire, and they begin to speak in other tongues. And they said, man, these guys got to be drunk. And they said, they ain't drunk. It's only the third hour of the day. And Peter began to preach the Word of God, and 3,000 souls come to the throne of God.
Amen.
Somebody ought to hear it.
Yeah.
When you got a church in unity, then you've got the throne of God open to everybody that wants to get to it. When you got unity, glory to God, every man will see the beauty and the righteousness of God.
Amen. Right.
That's pretty. I like that. You like your little flowers? I hate to tell you, made a bigger mess than I thought, but it's all right. That right there is what we've got in our churches.
Yeah.
That right there is what I look here. Look. There's a Church of God. Look, here's me, a Free Will Baptist right there. Oh, there's me, a Methodist. Thank you, Brother Tim. There's me, an Independent, a Baptist Costco. Come on. Somebody throw me. Oh, there's no regular. You see all that? Come on. That's what we've got. And look, we get a pile of blue ones on this side, and we get a pile of purple ones on that side. But we don't get what God intended it to be.
That's right.
We don't get what God intended it to be, Dad.
That's right.
We get a fraction of what God intended
That's right.
it to be. We can only do a fraction of the work of God when the body of God is in disunity.
That's right.
Yeah, I ain't got no shoes on. Don't worry about that. Be fine. Sister Sheila, I'll have you back in the sub later. But you occasionally find a church, Sister Tony. You occasionally find a church that's doing pretty good. And you get something that looks kind of pretty. Ain't it pretty? I like orange. Orange is a nice color. I like purple better. Ain't that nice? Ain't that good? Ain't that pretty? See, look at that church, Brother Ty. Look at that fruit that church is bearing. Ain't that cute?
Yeah.
Ain't that cute? But I want to ask you something. Is this not but a mere fraction of the power and the beauty of the intact, undefiled Church of God?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Oh, we get pieces of it, and it looks pretty. But it ain't the whole thing.
It's what God intended.
Oh, come on. Somebody ought to hear that tonight.
Come on. Amen.
Oh. So what do we do about that, Sean? We'll get there. Maybe. And what people see, Sister Diane, is not that pretty vase with all the fruit and the water that it holds. But they see a fraction of the beauty. Let me pick up my denominations here for a minute. Hold on. Better put that glass up there. Somebody get up here at an altar and you're going to be crying for a whole other reason in a minute. See, we get some of them churches and they start doing pretty good and we get a fraction of the beauty. And it looks cute. Don't that look cute? We ain't got no idea what we're missing, kids. We ain't got no idea what God intended. I'm going to tell you something. This is going to be hard to swallow. And I'm not trying to step too far outside of the bounds of reason, but I want you to understand me. The Catholic Reformation, Martin Luther's Reformation, come about because the Catholic Church was out of line. Can you say amen?
Yes, that's right.
And Martin Luther couldn't fix a Catholic church, so he basically split off and made his own church. Amen?
Amen.
But I'm going to tell you something. What would have been the ideal situation is for Martin Luther to have fixed the Catholic church.
They wouldn't let him.
But they wouldn't let him. I know that. But the ideal situation would have been that he would have fixed the Catholic church.
That's right.
But that's not what they had. They didn't want unity. Brother Daniel, they didn't want peace. And because if they didn't want unity and they didn't want peace, they don't really want the power of God.
Right.
Because see, the power of God means, Sister Tony, that I got to swallow my pride. The power of God says I may not get to preach every Sunday. The power of God says that I got to swallow some of my tradition. The power of God says that I got to forgive you when I don't want to forgive you. The power of God says that instead of getting mad and running out and scratching my itch, that I got to sit down and reason with you, Brother Tim, about what our differences is in the Bible. You said you can't prove it. Yes, I can. Because when Paul had differences with the early church, he hauled himself back to Jerusalem, Daddy, and they figured it out with prayer. Come on.
That's right.
And he abided by what his elders told him.
Yeah.
Now you think about that a minute. And then I want to tell you something, and please, this is hard, and I ask you to forgive me for the hardness, but I don't ask you to forgive me for the truth of it. That's the reason why that we have 75 denominations. That's why we have 65 Baptists. That's why there's a nickel and dime Pentecostal church on every street corner inside Eastern Kentucky.
Yep.
It's because we will not swallow our pride. We will not submit ourselves to authority. We will not believe the word of God, but we believe the traditions of man and the ideas of man, because we don't really want the power of God. We don't want a united church, because a united church means that I've got to change, and a united church means that I've got to do something different than I'm doing now. And a united church, come on, says that I've got to get off my pew and do some work. The united church says I feed the widows and I feed the poor and I visit the hospital and I visit the nursing home. Somebody ought to hear it today.
Yeah, come on. Yeah. It's the truth.
Ain't that a shame that I would take something that pretty and defile it?
Yeah.
You all didn't think I was going to throw it, did you? That's what we've got.
Yeah.
That's what we've got. You say, Sean, you've made a mess. That's fine. I'll clean it up. That's what we've got. Can you say amen?
Amen.
That's what we've got. We've got split, fractured pieces of life, but not the real thing, Brother John Bedwell. You ever had a mirror that's broke? Amen. You ever had a mirror that's broke and you're trying to look into it? What do you get? You get a piece of your face here and a piece of your face there, but you never get the whole. And then sometimes it's distorted and it's bigger than this and smaller than that. You don't even know how that happened. Right? Come on.
Yeah.
We got a fractured mirror.
Yeah.
We got fragments of what the church ought to be.
That's right. What we look like or what we should be.
And you know what? We're not willing. We're not willing to do what God said in Isaiah chapter 1. When he said, come, let us reason together. We're not willing, Brother Blake, to lay down our differences to find the commonality of God. Because I want to tell you something. Oh, I'm going to tell you something. I read a devotional the other day. I think I might even send it to the group if you've got some of the group texts that we do. How long has this church been rolling? 2,000 and some change? Or just about 2,000 years? We'll say in the year 33 they crucified him. That's a reasonable guess. And we're not quite 2,000 years down the road. Let me ask you something. Do you think that we worship God now like they did in the first century? Do you think that we worship God now like they did in the second century? Do you think that we're singing the same hymns? Do you think that they were using a nice little redback hymn? I hate to tell you, but I don't think they were singing Ain't No Grave in Latin.
No, probably not.
I mean, come on, get with me. You hear what I'm saying? I'm going to tell you that the women wasn't necessarily wearing blue jean skirts back then either. Can you hear me? And the men wasn't wearing dress slacks. Can you hear me? Come on. There was a different idea. I hate to tell you, but there probably wasn't a whole lot of makeup. Not because they maybe had a problem with it, but because there wasn't a whole lot of makeup.
Yeah.
But they did have a problem with it. But that's another conversation in and of itself.
Do you think we've done it like they're doing it? No. No, we're not. Why? Because we ain't them. And we don't know what they've done. We don't know how they looked. We don't know how they acted, other than what Paul gave us in the New Testament. We don't know, Brother John. But what has survived, Sister Deanna, what has survived for the last almost 2,000 years? There's one common ground that every generation and every church has had commonality in. There's a commonality in among every denomination. And Christ Himself said it. He said not one jot or not one tittle of the Word will pass away. And I'm going to tell you something. And I'm not being racist with this statement. But I don't care how dark of an African you are. And I don't care how red of a Native American you are. And I don't care how white of a Norwegian you are. Come on. You still worship the same God who sent His Son. Come on. It was the same Christ that they worshiped in 100 AD. And that's the same Christ I worship in 2016. Somebody ought to hear it tonight. Listen, our fragmented, ugly, useless pieces of denomination and non-denominational churches will eventually pass away. But there's going to be something that holds true, and that's the living Word of Jesus Christ.
Amen. You're right here.
Oh, but now it gets real. But now it gets real. I'm going to have to get that mess cleaned up before Paul gets here. He'll wonder what in the world I've done. Let me read you something before I get back real lady. He said in Proverbs 28, verses 10, and then you skip down to 19. He said, who causes the righteous to go astray in an evil way, he shall fall himself into his own pit. But the upright shall have good things in possession. 19. He that tilleth his land shall have plenty of bread, but he that followeth after a vain person or vain persons shall have poverty enough. Let me read this note I wrote. The Lord give me. Notice in those verses, if you cause the righteous to stray, you fall.
Yep.
And if you follow someone bad, you fall.
Yep.
That points to all the churches that have led people to fall. Amen?
Yep.
Either by sowing a seed, living a lie, or by destroying another church with their mouth.
Yep.
Oh, man. Now listen, this is a big statement for me. And I got differences with a lot of people, Sister Tony. And I will be real honest with you, I like to think I'm right. Got that covered, Brother John, right? But I better be careful about judging another man's servant.
That's right.
Because if I had been raised Free Will Baptist, I might be sitting in a Free Will Baptist. If I had been raised United Methodist, I might be sitting in a United Methodist. Can you hear me? If I had been Presbyterian, I might be sitting in a Presbyterian. Not because I don't love God, but just because He ain't drove me far enough down the road to see where I need to go. And you say, well, Shawn, you mean that you're going to get... Everybody thinks you're going to get drugged in here in the Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee. No, I don't know where God's going to drag me next, Brother John, but I'm willing to go.
Yeah.
But I'm willing to go, Dad. I'm willing, or at least I believe I'm willing, Brother Tim, to admit that I'm wrong about the Word of God, to admit that I don't know everything, and admit that I can grow in God, and that I can be taught something that I don't know.
Yeah.
To quote my grandfather, he said, if we argue and disagree, he said, you might be wrong. Or I might be wrong, or we both might be wrong.
Yeah. What do you say?
Man, ain't that crazy? Ain't that crazy?
Think about it.
But you see, he's coming back again. Every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord to the glory of the Father.
Amen.
Amen? That's what it says, Brother Daniel. And he said, no other name under heaven that is given by which men must be saved.
Amen.
Brother Timmy's coming back. And you know what we are to him? We're not the church. We're a bride.
Yeah.
What? We're the bride. The church is the bride. The church is the bride. We're built on one rock, one God, one Father, one faith, one Spirit. Right? Ephesians. We read that, chapter 4, 3 through 6. Matthew, built one rock. Our groom, the bridegroom, Jesus, is coming.
Yeah.
And he's coming, Daddy, for a bride.
Yeah.
Can you say that with me? A bride.
A bride.
A bride. Say it again. A bride.
A bride. A bride.
Now listen.
He's not a Mormon.
How many women you see up there? I heard that. We're going to ignore it. But amen, he's not. It's all right. We'll say that too. He ain't. How many women you see up there right now? Come on.
Come on, yeah.
How many fragments we got up there, Brother Kevin? How many denominations are laying shattered across that pulpit? Yeah. Let me tell you something. He ain't coming back after a harem. And he ain't coming after. Come on. Come on. You ought to hear me. He ain't coming after a bunch of concubines. But he's coming after a virtuous woman. He's coming after a virgin bride that is pure and white and holy and spotless without blemish before the throne of God.
Amen.
So we might as well just get comfortable with the fact that over the next decades of our life, the ideas of the shattered church begins to degrade and be gone down the drain, and we become a united people for Jesus.
We're going to.
Amen?
Amen. We're going to have to.
We're going to have to, Dad. There ain't no other options.
We're going to do it.
Oh, I realize that there's going to be some people left behind, Sister Tony. I realize there's going to be some people that will not conform.
Yeah.
Can you say amen, Sister Chris?
For real.
God help me not be one of those.
Amen.
God help me not to be one of those. It's amazing. But God's coming after a united bride. Nothing short or nothing less than one woman he's coming after.
One bride.
So the ideas of us being disembodied, there's a whole other sermon in that word alone. The ideas, Brother John, of us being disembodied as a church should be gone. Because I'm going to have to get out of my comfort zone. Somebody's going to have to compromise.
Yeah.
Listen, I hate to tell you, somebody's got to give some ground. Because if they keep thinking they're right and I keep thinking I'm right, somebody's not right. And maybe both of us. Now, I don't think I'm wrong. But I've got to be willing to say, God, help me to see the truth.
Yeah.
Can you say amen?
Yeah.
And you say, well, what should a church look like? You know what? I believe I'll spare you reading it. I believe I'll spare you reading it. But you know that chapter that we love to read on Mother's Day? Proverbs 31. How about we talk about the Lord's virtuous bride and not our mothers for a moment? Amen. I believe I will read that. I believe I will read that. Could I have a couple young men, if they would, to come and start throwing some of this stuff back on the tablecloth for me as I read these? And yeah, you better put your shoes on. Not safe to be here. Here, y'all thought we was going to handle snakes, and we're walking on glass. Close enough. What point are the others going to go, ain't it, Chris? You hear the snake? Proverbs 31. Let me clarify something. Proverbs 31 was not written by Solomon. Proverbs 31 was written by King Lemuel. He He said, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Now we're talking about the bride of Christ for a minute, not our mothers. Remember that.
Right.
Not your wives. We're talking about the church. Yep. Let's put it in context. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. Christ ain't going to have to worry about nothing else, Caleb. He's got what he needs in us. Can you say amen?
What are you looking for?
She will do him good. Wow. Just think about this as the church. She will do him good. And not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. He don't have to tell her what to do. She's up and about. She is like the merchant ships. She bringeth forth, or she bringeth her food from afar. In other words, she works hard and gathers everywhere that she can.
Yeah.
She riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. The church makes sure that its own is taken care of. Even at its own expense and even at its own rest, it takes care of its own.
Yeah.
Brother Tim. She considereth the field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hand she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. Can you hear that?
Amen.
How many churches have we seen with their candle out?
Yeah.
Come on, think about it for a minute. How many churches have we seen with their candle out? How many churches have we seen dead? How many times we preach out of Ezekiel, the valley of dry bones?
Yeah.
And we try to bring these churches back to life, Brother John, because they're dead, because their candle's gone out. Jesus told them in Revelation, he said, if you fool with me, he said, I'll take you a candlestick.
Yeah.
He didn't say it like that, but that's what he meant. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor. Yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet.
Yeah.
You see, we've already prepared our church. We've discipled them, Daddy, that they won't fall in the dry times.
Yeah.
Or in the cold times. Or in the hard times, Brother John. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates. Uh-oh. Her who? Her husband. Who's her husband? Jesus. You know why he's known in the gates? He ain't known in the gates because of him. He's known in the gates because of the church. He's known in the gates because of the virtuous bride.
That's right. Preaching here, students.
Be careful. Sit back in my office.
You don't care.
Where the talk was. Well, I got to get some rocks out of there. I can throw the rocks away. My daddy's raised me better than that. Thank you for the rock. Appreciate that. Yeah. Sketchy behind me here. Good thing, Brother Paul, you're accustomed to taking your shoes off. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land.
Amen.
The leaders of the land. Boy, you think about that alone, Daddy, is powerful.
Amen.
That alone, Brother Tim, says a lot about the church and its condition.
Amen.
When's the last time that our leaders have ever known God? Come on. When's the last time they recognized the church as God's bride? I mean, you think about that. Strength and honor. She maketh fine linen and selleth it and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing. What? Strength and honor? Oh, no. Now we're talking about honor, Sister Tony. That means we got to be honest. Oh, it means we got to behave honorably. Man, this just keeps getting worse and worse as we go. They're taking out all my fun, Sister Christy. Should I get on TV Creatures? I've been. Might as well, right?
She openeth her mouth with wisdom. Oh, well, now that, there we went. If we had survived up till that point, Brother Tim, that just shot us in the foot. If any of our denominations had held on until that point, Brother John, there they went down the tubes. You think about that for a minute. Opening her mouth with wisdom. I'll relay a story for a moment. I was in a church one night. There was a lady that behaved unseemly. And another lady intervened, and it caused a little bit of a ruckus. And I seen a very wise individual that I got a great deal of respect for in the Lord, who stood up with wisdom and calmed the whole situation. And nobody left. And nobody really got mad, so to speak. And the person that was in the wrong changed for the better.
Yes, she did.
The church opened its mouth with wisdom. Man, and her tongue is the law of kindness. Well, shucks. I had that wise thing going on, but see, I got to be kind now. That means I can't cut down Brother Jordan and Sister Lacey when I want to. That means I can't be mean to them, Sister Tony, because they ain't doing things the way that I think they ought to be doing. She looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of vileness. Well, all right. I don't think that there ain't nobody tonight that survived it so far. But the bread of vileness. I'm not supposed to be lazy, Brother John, in doing the Lord's work. Think about it, Tim.
Energy conservationist, man.
Energy conservationist. My wife has coined a new phrase for me. I am no longer lazy. I am an energy conservationist. I have become green, if you will. Borderline tree hugger right here. I am just conserving energy. If that's the case, and thank you, Missy said I do well as an energy conservationist. If that's the case, Sister Diane, we've got a great deal of churches that are energy conservationists because they sure in the world ain't doing nothing but burning the lights, and God knows they ain't touching the community, and God knows they ain't touching their family, and even when they got the opportunity, they're not opening their mouth with wisdom and their tongue with kindness. Come on, somebody out of here tonight. We're not being the bride of Christ. We're being a mutated, shattered fragment of what God wants us to be.
That's right.
Oh, her children, I rise up. I call her blessed. Her children. That would be the fruit, if you missed it. That would be the fruit that we're supposed to have as a church. That would be my children. Shout out to Brother Roy Harlow, pastor of Graceway Methodist, down there in Maytown. Me and him was in the barbershop the other day talking about stewardship, talking about discipleship, rather. And he said he was going through this a program teaching about discipleship, about how that we're continually supposed to be in the state of discipleship.
Yeah.
Brother Tim, that I'm always supposed to be teaching somebody.
Yep.
And I said, Tim, this is, Roy, I said, this is going to sound a little bit arrogant, or I said, don't take it this way, but I said, if I'm not leaving my mark on somebody, then I'm doing something wrong.
That's right.
Somebody ought to be affected by me. It ain't about me. They ain't supposed to see me. They're supposed to see God. But somewhere out there, Brother Caleb, there ought to be somebody with Shawn Tussey's mark on them. There ought to be somebody that was Shawn Tussey's disciple. Somebody ought to hear me. Not because that I'm that good, but because that I'm following the precepts of God. And when I'm put in a place of authority, Brother Tim, I'm supposed to take a disciple under my wing, and I'm supposed to start to teach him the ways of God. Yeah. Paul had a bunch of them.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, they begin to fight over it. And he said, some say I'm of Paul, and some say I'm of Apollos.
Yeah.
Why? Because they were disciples of those people. They took it too far, but that's not the point. My mark ought to be somewhere, Sister Diane, and if it's not, there's a problem.
Yeah.
I ought to have children. The church ought to have children.
Amen.
He said, if my name be lifted up, he said, I'll draw all men unto me. I can't help it. Glory to God, if I'm sincere with God and doing the work of God, I can't help but bear fruit for the kingdom of God. Can somebody
children to rise up and call her blessed. Her husband, there's that Jesus thing again. Her husband also, he praiseth her.
Amen.
Wow. Did you get that? When we're doing the right thing as the church of God, not the denomination, as the church of God, then God praises us. Excuse me, Christ praises us.
Yeah.
I like that a little bit better.
Present us to the Father.
Presents us to the Father. He said, if you're ashamed of me, he said, I'll be ashamed of you.
Amen.
Can you amen that? I don't blame me. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Oh, wow. Boy, if that didn't shoot our little broken face thing right to pieces right there. There's a bunch of them doing pretty good. You know what? I love Brother Henry Blackaby. Love Brother Henry Blackaby. Great man of God. Great man of God. Southern Baptist minister. Brother Blackaby's getting up in years. He's got some dementia or Alzheimer's issues. Got a lot of faith in him. Brother Blackaby almost single-handedly, by following the leading of God in the Southern Baptist denomination, spotted churches over the mass majority of Canada. From the 1960s on to the 1980s, I guess it was, Brother Kevin, he put churches all over Canada. By following God, by following the leading of God. He told the Lord when he came out of seminary, he said, I don't care how far, God. He said, if I can drive it and they want a Bible study or to plant a church, he said, I will go. There was days he'd have church on Sunday morning or on a morning and he would drive almost 300 and some miles round trip to go and have Bible study in another town.
Yeah.
Do you think about that? They've done well. The Southern Baptist has done well. The Church of God of Cleveland, Tennessee has done well. The Church of God of Prophecy has done well. The Assemblies of God has done well. I could say many more. I could name every denomination that has a stand or a name in a book. The United Methodists, the Free Methodists, the First and Second Baptists, come on, they've all done well. Can we say amen? Many of her daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. What the bride, the United Church, excels all of our other little futile efforts as individual churches. The United Church will prevail.
Yeah.
Favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord shall be praised.
Amen.
Come on. Give her the fruit of her hands and let her own works.
What about that now?
Let her own works praise her in the gates. I'm going to tell you something. Their works is not a $3 million building and a $6 million plane.
That's right.
Can you say amen to that, Blake?
Salvation of souls.
Let me tell you something. It's the ministry, Daddy. Worship and ministry. Ministry is a form of worship. Ministry. Why? Because when we're doing what God wants us to do, there ain't no fault in it, Sister Tony. The widows are fed. The fatherless are taken care of. The families are united. Oh, somebody hear that this evening. There ain't no divorce rate. Ain't digging. Making a point. Ain't no divorce rate. Hardly among the Amish and the Mennonites. You want to know why? Because they forgive.
Yeah. They forgive. That's true.
They forgive and they take their vows to God seriously.
Yes, they do.
See, they got something we don't. Amen?
I think so.
The Baptists, the Southerns, they plant churches like we plant corn. Mm-hmm. They sprout them up all the time. They got something we don't. All we got to give. But we keep them inside the church house and we use them for the show of power and not for the show of love. See, we got something that some churches don't, but we're not using it the right way. Can you say amen?
I believe so.
See, we've all got fragments of this big, beautiful, living organism called the church, Brother Tim, but we're not working in unison. If we took the power of Pentecost, and I'll use those denominations, that I just called out, not to exclude or include. But if we took the power of Pentecost, the forgiveness of the Amish, the church planting ability of the Southern Baptist, and the love of the United Methodist, have mercy, what could we do? Come on. What's that verse about a threefold cord is not easily broken? Is that close?
Yeah, real close.
A threefold cord is not easily broken. You know why some of these denominations are strong? Because there's multiple churches. Imagine if our denominations got together. Can you say amen?
We're going to.
Can we say amen?
Amen.
Give God some glory in here tonight. Altar call, but I do feel to have somebody stand and just pray for the congregation about that message, about what God would have us to have. Dad, would you please honor us with that prayer tonight? Let us bow our heads as Dad prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord. Lord, I ask right now that you would just open our hearts and our minds, Lord. We might receive this wonderful word, Lord. This word that you've kind of put into our hearts and our minds, Lord. To strengthen us for the days to come, Lord. That we might grow together in unity, Lord, with our brothers. Wherever they may be, Lord, glory to God. And whoever they may be. God, that we in these last days, Lord, that we can present a glorious church, glory to God, with a light that shineth all over. Glory to God, that whenever anyone looks at us, might not agree with us, but they have to say, Lord, they show different, ain't they? God, we ask you to touch us, Lord, and help us that we'll never back up. God, that we'll never back up, Lord, that we'll stand for you. And God, help us, Lord. God, help us, Lord, that we'll look for the coming of thy wonderful, blessed Son, Lord, one more time. Upon this earth, Lord, glory to God. Help us, Lord, to stand, glory to God, as we pray. As we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our elder brother, our blessed Savior, our Christ, Lord, we come to you, dear God, in his name. Amen.
Amen. Well, I tell you what, that worked out in about a good time as we ever could have made it work out.
Hallelujah.
Ty, come here and set this back up for me and clean.